بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessing of God be upon you all. Good morning, everyone. My name is Khalid Khan, and I teach at the University of Portland in the School of Engineering. And I have been involved in interfaith and intrafaith activities for the past 3+ decades in Portland area. And this morning, it's my distinct pleasure and honor to be introducing our speaker, a quiet and mild-mannered man, but highly accomplished. So I'll read a little bit of his biodata for you to give you an idea about his accomplishments. Dr. Nohad A. Toulon is Dean Emeritus of the College of Urban and Public Affairs at Portland State University and Distinguished Professor Emeritus of Urban Studies and Planning. He is an internationally recognized urban planner who contributed extensively to the development of major urban and regional plans in the United States and the Middle East, North and West Africa. Dr. Toulon has been an advisor to the United Nations Development Fund and to local and foreign governments on development issues. He was a member of the CRAG committee that drafted the Portland Urban Growth Boundary and has served and chaired numerous task forces for the city of Portland. He's a world traveler. We were just talking before this. And he has worked all over the world. A native of Egypt, he grew up in Cairo, Alexandria, the two cities there. And he received a degree in architecture from the University of Cairo, a master's degree in city planning from Berkeley, and a PhD from the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. In 1965, he became the first planning director of the Greater Cairo region, and he's the author of many of the concepts that continue to shape policy in that growing region. In 1966, he guided the development of new urban policies for the Cairo metropolitan area under UN United Nations auspices. In 1972, he came to Portland State University from New York, where he was on the Faculty of Architecture and Planning at Columbia University. In 1984-85, while on a 20-month leave of absence from Portland State, he directed the preparation of a very comprehensive regional plan for the Holy City of Mecca, which presented extraordinary challenges. And if you have been to Saudi Arabia, to Mecca, you know what the challenges are. He has received numerous awards in Oregon and nationally for his leadership and vision as a professional planner. His research and publications cover such diverse areas as city and regional planning, housing, and urban design. Again, it's my distinct pleasure to welcome Dr. Nohad Toulon.
Thank you for this lengthy introduction, and I do appreciate all the kind words that you said about me. I sometimes get nervous when introductions come very close to being longer than my speech, but again, I do appreciate the kind words that you said. I agreed to make this presentation about 3 weeks or 4 weeks ago while sitting on the ocean front in Punta del Este of Montevideo, where we have a summer home there. It was sunny and nice, and I didn't bother looking to my computer. I remember that I did write something about Islam and the media, and I may have given a speech. And then yesterday morning, after I finished putting all my notes, I discovered that I have given the exact speech to the same congregation. I know that the congregation may be different now, about 8 or 9 years ago. So I'm glad I wrote my notes before I look to the older ones. I do not intend to repeat myself, but this is a topic that is relevant at all times, but it's also continuously changing because it's not a religious subject, and on that account, I may be different from the previous two speakers that you had and the next three speakers that will be coming in the next weeks, largely because I'm not here to speak about Islam or any of the tenets of Islam or its philosophy. I'm here to speak about how Islam is being perceived today in the media, and I choose to make my introduction by looking to how it has been perceived in the Christian West since its inception back 1400 years ago. Islam and Christianity are not strangers to each other. As a matter of fact, when Islam first appeared, it was interpreted or perceived by the Christians of the Middle East as a heretic sect of Christianity. Some of them went as far as to describe the prophet as a renegade priest or a heretic. So in essence, the teaching are very much the same with some differences. Those differences are not minor, they are major differences. There is a difference on the nature of God. Islam, like Judaism, believe in the unity of God. Christianity, of course, the concept of the Trinity. And those are major differences, but that's where the point where the prophet was considered to be a renegade, changing the concept of the Trinity and coming with a religion that otherwise has the same values and the same tenets like Christianity. But I also am not going to talk today about the specific incidents in the media. If you are following the media, or if you have been following the writings of Jacques Shaheen, one of the first scholars to actually bring to our attention how much bias exists in the media toward Muslim and Islam, and particularly toward the Arabs, because other Muslims are not on the forefront of the conflict that currently exists. But and when it comes to bias, there is always a tendency to mix between Arabs and Muslims, failing to realize that actually the largest Islamic country in the world is Indonesia. Russia and India have more Muslims in them than any individual Middle Eastern country, perhaps except Egypt. And so it's Muslim and the Arabs are not one and the same. The majority of Muslims are non-Arabs, and not all the Arabs are Muslims. Egypt has a 10% of its population Christian, and that's out of 85 million, that's 8.5 million Christians living in Egypt. I would like to emphasize how the historical evolution of the relationship between Europe, Christian Europe, and Islamic Middle East. If you read Samuel Huntington's book, Clash of Civilizations, you will come to the conclusion that there has always been a wall between the Muslim East and the Christian West, and that wall has always is a very rigid wall, like the Chinese wall. There is no movement, there is no interactions between the two civilizations, and that those two civilizations have been continuously in clash with each other. And of course, Huntington's theory at the end is that there is nothing that we can do to bring harmony between Muslims and Christians, because or dealing with so-called radical Islam, largely because that's a historic conflict and it will always be there, has always been there, and will always be there. That actually is too much stretching of the facts. And there are so many people that have written about this subject, highlighting how porous that border between Islam and Christianity has been. First of all, there are Islam does not believe in forced conversion, and as a result, within Muslim lands, there are large Christian minorities. At the same time, when the Ottoman Empire began expanding, and because, again, of the reluctance to force conversions, there were very large Christian communities within the Ottoman Empire. The Greek, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, all these lands were under Islamic rule for large numbers. So in essence, the interactions have always been there. What the one thing that always when we talk about Islam and Christianity that comes to the forefront is the notion of the Crusades. And the Crusades were generally interpreted as religious wars between Islam and Christianity. And again, that is not true. What is true is that the first crusade or the anger that erupted in Europe as a result of the burning of the Church of the Sepulchre by a crazy ruler of Egypt, a ruler, by the way, that is known to have ordered his people to sleep during the day and work at night. So in essence, it's obviously that there was something about the personality of that man. But what we cannot deny is that he did burn the Church of the Sepulchre that created enormous anger in Europe and launched the First Crusade. But that, up to that point, the First Crusade was launched, and actually their first victims when they marched east, they didn't go by boat, they went by land, and the first city that they major city that they encountered was Christian Constantinople. And if you read the history and find what happened to Constantinople as a result of that crusade, the city was completely burned down, destroyed. Obviously, it was a different church. It's an Eastern church, it's not the Roman church. And so the first victims were Christians. So if you argue that the crusades were marching, largely attacking the Muslims, that is as an exaggeration. Yes, they did kill a lot of Muslims, they did kill a lot of Jews, but also they killed a lot of Christians. When they reached Jerusalem, the entire population of the city was slaughtered, and it included large numbers of Christians. So I'm not sure that if you focus on the fact that the conflict is between Muslims and Christians, that you will find evidence that suggests that that was true. Beyond the First Crusade, all the other crusades were politically motivated. So in essence, they were beginnings of conquest. And you'll be surprised how many second sons and third sons in families where the nobility moves only to the older son and he inherits everything and takes everything. And the second son started looking for principalities that they can establish somewhere or new titles. And so the Crusades became enmeshed in what is happening within the European social cultural systems, and at the same time became politically motivated. This is where you find that the Crusades do not play a very important role in creating animosities among the Muslims against the Christians because of that fact that they were really political wars. They were not. So if you want to argue that the Crusades were much closer to colonial wars that came in the 19th century, that is likely to be true. At the same time, and preceding the Crusades by three centuries, there was a flourishing civilization in Spain, actually one of the most pluralistic civilizations that you can find anywhere, where Muslims, Christians, and Jews coexisted in a very harmonious way. Most of the translation of the Greek philosophy and the Greek literature and did not move from Greek to Western Europe. It actually moved first to Spain and then entered Europe from the West. So that civilization, and I repeat it, is Muslims, Jews, and Christians, coexisted As a matter of fact, most of the caliphs of the Muslim empire in that area were relied on Christians and Muslims as their treasurers, as their editors. So in essence, they were employed in Muslim society. At the same time, the Spaniards to the north of Spain relied on many of the Arab scientists and the Arab writers as part of their courts. So in essence, the interactions were there. It was, again, it wasn't a straight cut situation in which this is the enemy and we will not deal with them. In Spain, as in many other areas, like in Russia, and there were alliances being established between Muslim rulers and Christian rulers against either another Christian ruler or against another Muslim ruler. So it wasn't the Muslims entirely and the liberty and clearly against the Christians or vice versa. So the interactions were there. Those interactions led also to knowledge. So it is not true, this is another thing that I need to dispel, that as we stand here and talk to you about Islam, that actually Islam was not known in Christian Europe. Islam was studied and the Quran was translated, as Mr. Maqsood explained to you 2 weeks ago, was translated first at the request of the Pope and eventually moved into other languages of Europe. The Quran, with its translations, came at about the time that the formation was happening in Europe. And I'm sure when you study the history of thought in Europe, you will understand that there was a movement among philosophers who wanted to apply reason and rational thinking to their understanding of religion. And with the translation of the Quran and with the exposure to writings that came earlier from Spain and some of the Arab writers that actually wrote about the nature of God and the nature of hell and heaven, found a receptive ear among the reformers who were beginning to question the concept of the Trinity and moving much closer to the Unitarian. And the predecessors of the Unitarian Church basically were rejecting the Trinity and moving toward much closer to the concept of God as it is stipulated by the Muslims and the Jews, which is the unity of God, very simple. Another thing when you're emphasizing reason and rational thinking is that they began questioning the notion of miracles or sins and so on. So the interest in understanding Islam grew during the 16th and 17th century. It's not something that happened in the last 100 years. In the 16th, 17th century, there were individuals in Europe who were beginning to study and understand the basic phenomena of Islam. They never accepted them. They never declared that they are Muslims, so don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that they converted, but they adapted many of the ideals that appear in the Quran to their thinking. Christopher Walker is a man who wrote a book 2 or 3 years ago called Islam and the West. And if you are interested in understanding what happened during the period that I just covered now, he covers it in a 300-page book. I covered it in 10 minutes. He actually asks one question. He asked as to whether the American Constitution is not actually an Islamic Constitution that has a lot of the values of Islam. And the reason he's not stipulating that it is, but he's asking the question. And the reason he's asking the question is because John Locke, again one of the philosophers of the 16th century, that admired Islamic teachings, and he wasn't a Muslim himself, but he admired many of the teachings of Islam. And John Locke actually was the most influential writer that the founding fathers of this country admired and read his writings and were influenced by him, especially Benjamin Franklin. And those are the people that wrote the Constitution. And that's why the question by Christopher Walker as to whether Islam really didn't play a role in influencing the drafting of the American Constitution. Having said that, the reason I'm taking this approach at the beginning is to point to you that it's not really an inherent conflict. It's a conflict that we never, for political reasons, there are conditions that exist between the Muslims and the Christians, comes to the forefront. Other than that, it's not a conflict of a belief, it's not a conflict that that cannot be addressed, that people cannot coexist with it. Another aspect of the fact that there was admiration on both sides could be seen with the 18th and 19th century British philosophers who wrote about their admiration for the Ottoman Empire. The Ottoman Empire was a very, very oppressive empire. It's not something that anyone will want to admire, but their admiration for the Ottoman Empire was because they refer to it as one of the most pluralistic societies that you can find, where people of different religions coexisted and lived together. At the same time, the Muslims were looking to things that are happening in Europe, and the exchange is both ways. And I would like to just make give you a statement that was made by one of the most distinguished Islamic scholars of the 19th century, Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, who influenced Islamic thought in Egypt and the Middle East for a very, very long period of time, until actually more conservative approaches to Islam began to appear in that area. Muhammad Abdu traveled to Europe and came back, and as he landed from Alexandria, he was asked, "What did you find?" And he said, "I went to the West and I found Islam without the Muslims. And I came to the East and I found the Muslims without Islam." So basically, he's stating that I went and I found that in the West, Islamic values are being maintained, are being respected. And I came to the East and I found that all what you are doing are following the rituals, but the values, the true values of Islam are being ignored. That is, he is not the first person to stress this issue. So in essence, there has been exchanges and admirations on both sides looking for areas of common between the two religions. That doesn't change the fact that when it comes to basic dogma, there were major differences. And but nobody discussed those major dogmas as a central issue, unfortunately, until we started getting satellite television and getting all this media, where you can get people standing and saying things without understanding what are the ramifications and the implications to people who are listening to this. I want to come back to the subject of the media. So if that's the case, why are you witnessing, or why are we witnessing today this surge in anti-Arab, anti-Islamic incidents in our media, and both of the written as well as the visual? Well, if you understand the line of thought that I was taking you, it's the whole thing in the relationship between Islam and Christianity has been centered on political issues. It's not necessarily on religious issues. And that's exactly what we are facing now. With the 19th century, we have the beginning of European colonialism. Much of the Middle East and North Africa came under the domination of three countries, Britain, France, and Italy. And the atrocities that happen usually with colonialism led to basically blurring the difference between politics and religion. But there is one development that occurred at the end of the 19th century that's by all likelihood responsible for much of the hostility toward Islam and Arabs that you see in this country. And in Europe is a different story. It's not the same situation. There is hostility toward Islam and Arabs, and but primarily toward Islam in Europe, but that's a different reason. I will come back to it later. But in our country here, we have the Zionist declaration for the establishment of a Jewish state in Palestine, which was supported by the British, and we have the Balfour Declaration that led to the eventually in 1948 the establishment of a Jewish state and the end of the freedom or independence or freedom of choice for the Palestinians. So a new conflict emerged in the Middle East, and that's a conflict between the Arabs and the Israelis. And of course, that coincided with the terrible events of the Holocaust and the sympathy that were generated toward the right of the Jews to return back to a homeland. Very little attention was paid to the fact that the return back to the homeland was also being done at the expense of the suffering of the indigenous population that was living there. While many of the Arabs during the Second World War were working, trying to save Jewish refugees. I still remember my mother working in refugee camps, trying to process Jewish refugees who are being moved by boat from Europe to Alexandria so that they can put them on trains and take them down to Sudan and then from Sudan to South Africa, move them away. At that time, the Nazis were on the doors of Alexandria and threatening to occupy Egypt. So Egypt could have been a very dangerous place for Jewish refugees if they would have kept there. But they found that Israel is being established at the expense of the Arabs of that area. That's the beginning of the conflict that actually leads continuously to the attempts to dehumanize the Arabs in order to justify whatever is being done to them. That's a major conflict, and that's the major conflict that is impacting actually the relationship between the Arabs and Muslims and the United States, largely because of the strict support of the United States to all Israeli policies. When you engage into something like this, the tendency is that you want to justify actions by referring to individuals who are struggling for their freedom by whatever terms you want that will dehumanize them. The Irish, Protestant, and Catholics fought each other. There were that much atrocities committed against the Irish and the Protestants in Northern Ireland, but nowhere you are going to find any reference to the term Protestant terrorists or Catholic terrorists when it comes to the reference to what's happening in Ireland. There are many other countries where fighting occurs, but you'll not find any mention to the word terrorism. You may find, even in Chechnya, fighting the Russians, they are Chechen militants, not necessarily Chechen terrorists. And definitely, nobody will use religion to describe those people, those terrorist activities. It's very easy to just refer to Islamic or Muslim terrorists. Islamic terrorists have become a very accepted term. So when you start using that term very frequently, it basically becomes very easy to accept that it can reflect on the entire population. And whether maliciously or otherwise, the media falls in the trap of repeating these slogans. And the more you repeat them, the more you desensitize the people to how terrible these terms that you are using. Any terrorists who are fighting, no matter what they claim, but they are not fighting on behalf of the religion. So in essence, describing them as Islamic terrorists. And we also, when we do this, tend to forget what we contributed to the rise of some of these movements. I just will remind you that when the Russians invaded Afghanistan, it was the Reagan administration that encouraged Saudi Arabia to send teachers to the Pakistani-Afghanistani border to train and educate young people and indoctrinate them so that they go in and fight the Russians. The idea was that Islam opposes communism, and I'm not sure that that was 100% true. Yes, Islam largely because of the nature of society in the Arabian Peninsula is a capitalist and advocates freedom of commerce, freedom of preserving capital, and so on. But it doesn't mean that it's against communism per se. But that's what how it was interpreted. If you send, if you get all those young Muslims and ship them to Afghanistan, they are going to be fighting the communists who are non-believers, don't believe in God. And we fail to realize that that yes, you can make turn those young people into very radical, militant, religious fighters. But when they finish the mission, and they did finish the mission, they are likely to turn their attention to something else. And that's what happened. They turned their attention not only to us, but they turned their attention to their own societies that they disliked what they found in it. Is that really Islamic terrorism? It's is a geopolitical situation where our politicians are as guilty as anyone in creating that movement. So why do we suddenly turn it, when they start behaving in a way that we don't like it, into Islamic terrorism? We didn't call them Islamic terrorists when they were killing the Russians. We called them Islamic terrorists when they turned on us. And in reality, the innocent party in the middle is Islam and the Muslims, who have really nothing to do with all these arrangements that were being made. So we tend to inject political issues, and then when the results become unacceptable to us, then we can find excuses to blame the others. My point here is that the media, and I don't want to say maliciously, because I am familiar with various elements of the media that tends to be very objective, and they are trying to cover Islam very objectively. But the media is also is entrapped. They entrapped by their own slogans and by their own approaches to the conflict. They don't see the other side of the conflict. Some of them will, some of them, most of them will not. So that's the question that I have to you here, is that if the media continues to mix between political conflicts without understanding what are the ramifications of what they are saying, to the essence of the religion that they are attacking. One example that you can find happening now is what's happening in Egypt. The Muslim Brotherhood is winning, and the Salafis, that nobody incidentally other than their followers like in Egypt, are gaining votes. But suddenly we become scared from Islamists taking over Egypt, failing to realize that we have our own radical Christians here, that when they influence politics, we talk about it as a problem, but we don't talk about it as a major disaster or something that we are fearing or afraid. We know that eventually, in a free elections, things will clarify themselves. But when it comes to Islam, the fear is there. And that brings me to another point, is that much of what we do in trying to relate to Islam is actually pushed by our fear. And that fear is an artificial fear. The Muslims really never fought Christians as Muslims fighting Christians. They fought them as Turks fighting Greeks, or as Egyptians fighting whatever. But it's not the question of Muslims fighting Christians. As a matter of fact, in the Middle East, you have always, until very recently, I have to say that, there was a very great constraint when it comes to any references related to Christianity, largely because you have large number of Christians living in the society. So how can you say anything negative about their religion? So as I said, some of these things are changing because of the ease and freedom by which any crazy individual can establish his own satellite station and say whatever he wants to say. But that's a problem, a different topic. That's a problem of really the ease by which communication and is becoming available to people who are responsible or irresponsible. And so that's the problem that we have here, is that we have to be able to distinguish between conflicts that have political roots and conflicts that have religious roots. And much of the conflicts that is causing negative images about Muslims and Islam in this country are political. And they really should be addressed and seen as such. Now, when you start hearing irresponsible actions or irresponsible statements, and you don't stand up and correct them as a responsible person in politics, then that's when you begin to be guilty of the same situation. I will have to cite some examples here. One of the candidates running for president recently made a statement that Muslims should be banned from service in the armed forces. Why? There were a couple of crazy individuals that committed crimes. These are crimes. They are not religious crimes. They are, and they should be prosecuted accordingly. That doesn't mean that Muslims have to be banned from serving in the armed forces. When you say this, and you have nobody rebutting this from the side of, yes? Yeah, that's yeah. That's not religious as such. This is why I mean, you are right, but I'm referring to the religious impacting religious groups, and banning Muslims from serving in the military is actually a disrespect for the hundreds, if not thousands, of Muslims that have been killed and wounded in the Iraqi and Afghanistani conflict. There are a large number of Muslims serving in the armed forces. Not all of them are Arabs. You have to keep in mind that when we talk about Muslims in this country, we are talking about a very large contingency of African Americans who adopted Islam, or as they say about themselves, they reverted to Islam. And those serving in the armed forces, talking about them that should not be allowed to serve there, is actually doing a great disservice to those ones who are serving there. Newt Gingrich, that's again, it goes to the Palestinian problem and trying to gain favor. And again, it just tends to emphasize. Unfortunately for Newt, he was rebuffed by almost everybody that read that statement, including some of the leaders of the Jewish community. So in essence, that's the essence of the conflict is political. And we have to be very careful before we start branding the entire religion and entire community as either terrorists or as being disloyal to this country. That the number of Muslims in this country who have fought in the armed forces, who have actually excelled in the sciences, who have contributed significantly to this country, Those are the examples that we should be highlighting, and not the examples of the crazies. And every community and every religion has its own crazies. And if we keep highlighting those ones, but unfortunately we tend to highlight those ones in the case of Islam. And I come back to the point of there are groups in this country that would like to dehumanize the Arabs and dehumanize the Muslims for political purposes. Europe is a different story. Following the end of the war, Germany in particularly, and France for a different reason, found themselves attracting a large number of immigrants from Turkey and North Africa. North Africa, in the case of France, because France for many, many years, almost 100 years or 130 years, has declared Algeria to be a French province, which technically means that all Algerians, regardless of their religion, were allowed free access to France. They are part of France, they were French people. So there are a large number of Algerian Muslims living in France. Turkey they came out of the war with a shortage of labor, shortage of workers, and Germany and Turkey have, regardless of the neutrality of Turkey during the Second World War, but the Germans and the Turks for about 100 years have been very close to each other. So they found it convenient to import large number of Turks. Turkey is a 99% Muslim country, so those were Muslim workers that moved in large numbers to Europe. Situations of the labor force change. Another thing is that very, very little efforts were made to encourage the assimilation of the Turks that moved to Germany or to North Africans that moved to France and lately to Spain. So they remained very separate communities with their own cultures, with their own traditions, and which are alien to the Germans. So now what you find the resentment there now is that Germans were talking about the fact the country is becoming less and less German. That is, could be true, but only if you make no efforts to provide, to first of all, accept their religion as a mainstream religion. Secondly, allow for some cultural assimilation so that they become part of the German society. We don't have that problem in our country here, largely because we don't have a problem of assimilation of immigrants that come to the United States. All of us are, in one way or another, came here as immigrants or our parents or grandparents. And so the notion of we are not, there is nothing called pure American race as you will find pure German race or pure French race. But in Europe, the problem is different than here. It's not politically based, it's culturally based, and it's actually, it's fear of the Europeans of losing their great majorities or their identity as a result of the immigration of large number of people. But that's, again, tends to be exaggerated in the media as being a Muslim problem, failing to realize that in France and in some of the northern countries, the majority of the immigrants are not Muslim. The majority of the immigrants are actually Africans. So they are still racially different, but they are not really, it's not a problem of Muslims changing the face of society. So Europe is a problem of immigration and the changing face of the societies there. In our case, it's really a problem of how can we deal with political situations that force us all the time to try to dehumanize people because we cannot refer to the, we call Hamas a terrorist organization. Nobody will ever refer to them as perhaps a freedom fighter. And nobody will refer to Hezbollah in Lebanon in any way other than a terrorist organization. I think there has to be a very careful assessment of what are those people doing. And again, I will just conclude by reminding you that after the terrible tragedy, crime of 9/11, President Bush came with a statement that they hate us because they hate our freedom. I think if you are following what's happening in the so-called Arab Spring, you realize that they really don't, even the most conservative Muslims, they don't hate our freedoms. They love our freedoms and they want to enjoy the same freedoms. But they do hate our policies. And there is a distinction between the two. And if we define problems correctly, we are likely to be able at least to understand what is the nature of the conflicts that we are facing. And having said that, and I had promised that I will not go on forever. I'm not, as you notice, I'm not speaking out of notes. And I can go indefinitely, but I would like to allow you some questions if you would like to ask. So I just will conclude by summarizing that anyone that will interpret existing conflicts between Islam and Christianity as something that has been going on for 1400 years, and as such, there is no way to change it, that's a fallacy. That's not true. There has, yes, there have been wars, but there has also been social, intellectual interactions between the two civilizations. And what we need to emphasize is the benefits that came out of those interactions and not necessarily the military conflicts that have been going on. Christians fought Christians, Muslims fought Muslims, Christians fought Muslims, Muslims fought Christians, Christians fought Hindus. That doesn't mean that it really was entirely religions fighting each other. It was political system or institutions fighting each other. The other point I will leave you with is that when you encounter references to things like terror, Islamic this, Islamic that, you have to ask yourself, why is it only the Islamic religion to which those terms are being applied? Why we never heard about Hindu terrorists, for example, and there are a lot of terrorist activities in India. But we hear about Hindu militants, which is a better description, perhaps. So in essence, that's the one things that you have to ask yourself. The more you keep repeating the negative terms and associate them with a religion, they begin to take over, and you lose sight of what are the great things that exist in that religion, what that religion offers to the rest of the world, and how can we all, whether we are Muslims, Christians, Jews, Hindus, Buddhists, live and coexist based on our respect of the religions that we all, and incidentally, all religions have one thing in purpose, and that's to be good. All of us take care of each other and good behavior, and do what we think will satisfy God and give us His blessings. And with this, I will conclude, and I will take any questions if you want. Yes. Yes.
Isn't it difficult to kind of bifurcate the politics and the religion, especially in Islam states like Iran or Hezbollah and Palestine, when these governments are actually calling themselves this? I mean, it seems rational to me that the media would pick up on that because that's what they're saying overtly, and it seems like the unrest in Western Africa seems to be more and more going into political Islam states. It seems that as time goes on, it's going to be tougher to bifurcate the politics and the religion in those areas.
Yeah, I don't like the term political Islam because for us to basically accept the notion that Islam is pushing these people to do whatever they are doing, You have to keep in mind that in Christian traditions in Europe, the Muslims were infidels. And that term was used until the beginning of the 19th century. They were the infidels. It was a derogatory term. During the Reformation, when I mentioned the beginnings of the Unitarian, actually the term began to disappear, and particularly in England. But it has always been there. In Muslim traditions, you cannot refer to the Christians and the Jews as infidels, because they are the people of the book. And so when you come to a conflict, like in Nigeria, for example, which is basically a political conflict today, but the groups that are fighting are Muslims and Christians, and begin to attribute that to the rise of a militant, radical Islamic movement that is out to dominate, I think you are ignoring the fact that Islam does not advocate these things. Islam advocates harmony between the Muslims and the people of the books, as indicated by when all these lands were taken over by the Arabs, nobody touched the Christians. The Christians remained. The 8.5 million Christians in Egypt today are descendants from the ancient Egyptians there, which means they have been there for 1,400 years. But when you look to conflicts, you have to look to what are the political parameters behind those conflicts before we start attributing them to really religious wars. Yes, there are so many people that use religion in order to attack or use religion as an excuse for crimes and violations that they are doing. Unfortunately, there is very little you can do about people who ascribe to themselves that they are fighting in the name of religion. And we have had incidents in our country here where Christian militants are fighting using the name of Christianity for the same purpose. So I see your point, but we live in an age in which everybody can declare what who they are and what they stand for. But that doesn't mean that they stand for the religion, or they actually understand that the religion forbids them from doing what they are doing. And the media, and I'm here talking about the media, has a responsibility to be able to realize those issues rather than falling in the trap of carrying the stories and the events with that kind of emphasis on them. So that's my point. Yes?
I don't think it's widely known in the West that Jesus is considered a great prophet of Islam. And would that kind of provide a bridge between Christianity and Islam?
Yeah, and that's what I did refer very briefly to that the major difference between Islam and Christianity is, when it comes to dogma, is the concept of the Trinity and the nature of Jesus. But Jesus is actually it's not only Jesus. Jesus, Moses, and all the prophets mentioned in the Old Testament are recognized prophets by the Quran, and they are mentioned by name. And they are what applies to the Prophet Muhammad applies to them. For example, nowhere you will find any film depicting Jesus or Moses appearing in a movie theater in Egypt or any other place. The Ten Commandments, when it was made and filmed in Egypt, you should have seen the uproar from the Azhar about showing Moses, Charlton Heston, as Moses appearing there. And the film eventually was banned. You cannot personify prophets. It's not only Muhammad that you cannot do that, it's also all the other prophets. But as I said, I'm really, there are other speakers who are speaking about the nature of Islam and what is cheating. I just wanted to focus here on the sensitivities that we should have when we begin to describe a religion with derogatory terms, failing to realize that this tends to dehumanize. But thank you. Yes, Jesus is, as a matter of fact, and that's perhaps another point, is that the Quran says that Jesus was never crucified. Whether he was put, when you argue he was put on the cross, some of the interpreters of what it means in the Quran will argue that God lifted him up before they put him on the cross, which basically what they put on the cross was a dead body. But these are all kind of interpretations. You can go through them. But Islam does assign to Jesus in particular a very, very honorable and very respected place. Yes, please. Well, Newt Gingrich, just to be accurate about what he said that the Palestinians are invented people, that there was no Palestinian state. They were part of the Ottoman Empire. They are Arabs, which is a true statement. They are Arabs. But there are the Egyptians are Arabs, the Syrians are Arabs, the Iraqis are Arabs. So that's basically the essence of his statement. The question is what does he have so fine? They are invented people, but there are 5.5 million of them there, so what's he going to do with them? But any other questions? Yes, please. It's the nature of the human. I mean, this is our nature as human beings. And we do subscribe to the religions, but when we behave in our daily life, extremely very few of us ask questions as to whether what am I doing adheres to the religion that I believe in or does not. So in essence, we tend to have expediency when it comes to if I understand your question correctly, and the most dangerous thing for religion is if a religion turns out, is turned entirely into a matter of rituals, without trying to understand the spirit of the religion and its meaning and why it is there, and apply it to everything, whether taking care of the poor, whether taking care of justice in society. And so I think that's, yes.
I got my answer.
You got your answer.
I have a question made of the congregation here. Those who buy the keys, Christmas keys, they have a right to dream too. It's a homeless center for North West Falls in Birmingham, and they are selling things to raise money to meet their expenses. So those of us who like peace, I'd appreciate it if they do that there. Thank you.
Yes? Yes, there was a question in the back, and then I'll come. Yes, but can you speak loud a little bit?
Yes. As a counterpart to mainstream American media, do you think El Jazeera serves a real balancing act? I know I listen to a few programs a week. And I always find it fascinating because I lived for many years in the Middle East. But it's something that never seems to permeate through to the general American media.
No, it doesn't. Of course, if you, and I don't want to deal with political issues here, but if the only station that on television that you are listening to is Fox News, then you will think that what's happening in the Middle East is just a bunch of fanatic, crazy Muslims who are out to destroy the whole world. There are other stations where you can get some balance covering, but in most stations, if they don't want to be anti-Arab or anti-Muslim, they will be neutral, which basically means say nothing. So they are not going to be going into explanations of what is the background. Every once in a while, you will get some commentator referring to what the CIA has done in creating that militancy in Afghanistan. But you're not going to find that very often being discussed as the reason why those militants that we are fighting them, that are fighting, came to be there in the first place. And if you don't understand why they came to be there in the first place, the tendency is to say they are basically the Islamic movement. They are not. They are adherence to a very narrow version of Islam that was sent to that area as part of an attempt to fight the Russians. And we lost control of it. We thought that we are controlling them. We lost control of them. Very few elements of the media will go into that kind of a comprehensive coverage of why things are happening the way they are and what, if any, role we may have played in this. There is a question. There are any questions? Yes, go ahead, please. Go ahead.
I recall that Indonesia is the largest Muslim country.
Yes. Like all Muslim countries, they have their own local bred extreme militants who don't like the government that they have, who are engaging into terrorist activities against their own people. But actually, the ones in Indonesia, we never refer to them as terrorists. We refer to them with the name of the organization that they have. The same was in almost, I mean, the Saudis have their own version of Al-Qaeda that is trying to topple their regime. And Egypt has the militant Jamaa Islamiyah that assassinated Sadat and for many years was trying to destabilize. But the point here is that in Islamic countries, nobody refers to them as Islamic terrorists. They are just basically criminals, and they are being prosecuted as criminals, not as terrorists particularly. And so that's the situation. It's we live in a very complex world, and as I said, those movements have always there. They have always been there. Remember that the assassins that came out in Lebanon was again a movement that could have been interpreted as a terrorist, but it was directed not toward Christians, it was directed toward Muslim rulers in that area, and particularly Syrian and Iranian rulers. Yes?
I believe the ill attitude of the West and America towards Islam is only political, because they don't know enough about Islam really to criticize it. There's one thing odd that I see is the Christian countries that are Christian, they forget that Jesus himself is a Middle Eastern man. He's not European, so they forget that. He is from the Middle East. And so there's a lot of respect for him. At times in some countries, they make him the creator of the universe, which is, you know, like the highest respect to somebody. But we should not forget that that Christianity started from the Middle East, and all the books that were written on it were taken to Greece and then finally to England and were printed for the whole world, the Bible, by King James. My idea, my opinion is pretty shite, whatever. You understand what I'm talking about. So, we got to realize all this too, you know. So, coming back to my first line, the ill attitude, which there is, it's political, and it's not going to be removed as long as it's political. It's going to stay there. It's not anti the Islam itself. Because like any other religion, Islam is good and it's bad. Christianity has its goodness and its badness. Judaism has its goodness and its badness. My last point, both Christianity and Islam were taken from Judaism because it was the oldest organized religion. Without Judaism, there wouldn't have been Islam and Christianity. You know, another point, the God of Jews is the same as the God of Muslims. Do not forget. I want people to realize that. Because, for instance, in stories of the Bible that are in the Quran, like about Abraham and his son, it's written in the Quran as well as in the book of Jews and Christianity. And they refer to the same God. So, yeah, these are the things Americans don't know, and I'm glad I love the topic you talked about, and I could view my point there too. Thank you.
Well, thank you. For us Muslims, the God of the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims is the same God. While differing on the question of what is the nature of that God because of the Trinity, but it is the same God, so we're all worshiping the same God. But thank you for your statement. Okay, is there one? Yes, please.
Do you think that at the end of this point, the Arab Spring, that it will start coming before a lot of the conflict going on in the Middle East has to do with economics and politics and not religion? Do you think that will assist with that?
Well, I gave a speech about that subject at Portland State last Tuesday. I I don't usually use the term Arab Spring, but Tahrir Square, which is now the symbol of all what's happening in the Middle East, even in Syria, is no longer a square. Tahrir Square is a state of mind. And when the Salafis, the extreme conservative radical Islamists that won 25% of the vote there, they don't have any chance of getting to government. But when I was asked about that, my answer is that even if they reach government, remember the Tahrir Square is there and it's not going to disappear, which means the people have been empowered, they empower themselves. And so it's going to be a democracy, and I'm very optimistic about the chances of democracy there. The only way that Tahrir Square is going to disappear is that if whichever government comes in decides that they want to stay there forever, like what the Iranians did, the mullahs. Well, there are no mullahs in Egypt. That's one thing. And Sunni Islam is different from Shia Islam. While I'm not questioning really Shia or Sunni at this point, but they are different. And so what happened in Iran is going to be very difficult to happen in Egypt or Libya or Tunisia. So if democracy prevails there, there are going to be changes. And if we start interpreting those changes as being Islamic radicalism directed toward our interests in the region, then we are going to be repeating mistakes of the past. If you, on the other hand, we accept the reality of democracy, after all, every president that we had in the last 40 years have been criticizing the Middle Eastern countries for the lack of democracy. And there are many people who wrote on the subject and said, but remember, under democracy, you are going to get governments that reflect the desires and the interests of their own people. And those governments are not likely to be very friendly toward us unless we are willing to change our policies. So, and the central issue here is going to be, what is the government in Egypt, if it is a Muslim Brotherhood, going to do? Remember that Hamas, that we call a terrorist organization, is the Palestinian branch of the Muslim Brotherhood that's going to rule in Egypt. So if we think that they are going to be ignoring Hamas, they may not go to war with Hamas against the Israelis. They may not go to war against the Israelis, period. And they have indicated their support for the treaty that exists. But they are not going to be like the previous dictator, where if the Israelis go out into massive invasions and killings of Palestinians, that they are going to stay quiet. So there are changes in the region, and the sooner we adapt our policies and adapt ourselves to those changes and accept them, the greater the chances that we will achieve peace in that part of the world, finally and once and for all. But there are changes. Democracy reflects the attitude of the people. It's not the attitude of the dictator who's sitting on top. And that's what we got and what the Israelis got out of Mubarak for the last 30 years. That's not going to be the same, and no matter who forms the government in Egypt. That's going to be questioning from now on. You want us to support you? Are you supporting our causes? We support your causes, and so on. So in essence, it's a mutual, it's no longer a one-way street. And I believe that that is the major change coming to the Middle East as a result of the Arab Spring. And the sooner our leaders and the Israeli leaders and other leaders in Europe come to terms with that kind of change, the better the outcome is likely to be.